Добрий вечір. Good evening. This is a very, very unique broadcast of this evening at Громадське. You rarely have high-level Ukrainian politician with a foreign politician and expert speaking and discussing the essence of the way the countries are run. So we just watched this Swiss movie. It's a special project Громадське makes with the Swiss embassy here to show you a bit how the democracy works. But in the studio, we would have now very informal and interesting discussion with a unique group of people. So we have here Olga Evazovska, who is head of the probably most important Ukrainian watchdog on the parliament, Opora, and Krista Makwalder is the president of the Swiss National Parliament, the parliament which is one of the oldest in the world, Oksana Siroid, who is the vice speaker of the Ukrainian parliament, and Mary O'Hagan, who is the director of National Democratic Institute in Ukraine, but has incredible background in working in the Balkans, Georgia, Russia, and Africa, and the UK, and numbers of countries. So why are we here? We would like really to understand and to share this knowledge, to understand what's working, of course, here, not in Ukraine by this stage, what is the price of compromise. So probably, you know, as we have your, as a honorary guest, Krista, we would ask, you know, how really this, we just watched the movie, but the price of compromise in Switzerland, we always think that it's, you know, like it's well-established country, people are very polite, very well organized, so probably it's all going very easy. Is it really like that? Aren't there the fights and the other things?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your kind invitation. And of course, in Switzerland, we do not have easygoing politics. So we also have our political debates, which can be rather harsh. And as you have seen in the movie, there are also political positions differing much from each other. But we have maybe a special system with working with changing majorities in parliament, so we don't have a coalition government and the parliament to follow the parliament's majority, while our ally from today is our enemy, from political enemy from tomorrow. But we have to be friendly to each other and we have to find compromises. And this is, of course, a learning from the Swiss political system. Compromises are to be considered, to be typical Swiss, because we always have also to include our language minorities. We have a lot of variety living in Switzerland, and that's why compromises are extremely important and they are not easy to obtain.
And Oksana, I think for us the compromise is sometimes that people are voting for the good reason, but sometimes violating the procedure, as for instance we know this way that people vote for the other SMPs in order to reach either these constitutional amendments or some anti-discrimination law. So what is the price for a compromise you have paid?
It's also a very difficult question, because the current parliament is already the story, yes, and it's it had its previous story and the previous legacy. And when I personally came to parliament, which was less than 2 years ago, I believe that it's so easy, that it's so obvious. When you have the rules of procedures, you just step in, you adhere to those rules of procedures, and everything will be working. Unfortunately, people first that used to practice different rules and procedure not written and maybe not appropriate very often. For them, it was no sense to change them, like not to adhere to the normal rules and procedure. And with that time, you understand that yes, you'd have to compromise, unfortunately. Even though probably sometimes I feel that I'm the only one who is trying to raise this voice that we have the rules and procedures and we have to adhere to them. But I think what is even more important that to distinguish the compromise and between the compromise and the deal, or the compromise or consensus and the deal, because when you the compromise means that everybody wants to achieve the same goal. But the deal is when somebody has the goal and everybody has to adhere to this goal. So, and my biggest problem and my biggest challenge is not the compromise in a good sense, in the pure sense of this world, but the deal. So when somebody has made a decision and just come to you and say, this is the deal, you have to follow.
Oksana, your organization is really following and, you know, keeping the members of parliament accountable. So really, do you see that there is this sometimes compromise for good made by violating the procedures or some other issues should be raised and maybe somehow fixed?
I think that in Ukrainian framework or in Ukrainian situation, the world of compromise has a bad background. You know, because democracy is a procedure and rules too. It's not only good decisions and, I don't know, hearing from society some ideas and so on and so forth. That's why I think that compromise is not enough as a reason or to make some deals. And if you are talking about decision-making process, rules is very important too, because it's a framework from different bad guys and different bad ideas to adopt something because of war, because of political crisis, because of corruption, but not openly. You know, that's why I think that we have a good progress in Ukrainian parliament. If you try to compare this parliament and previous one or two previous session and so on and so forth. But I think that if our parliament has the rule to adopt laws, they should be more open to do not deals but to work according to the law too, and they can broke this law.
And Mary, you worked in different turbulent places.
Yes.
Where it's very hard to reach something. So what is way out? You know, you can give the examples, but I think, like, can you really make people to to do the compromises in that way?
I think all politics is about interests of one sort or another, and when it comes to consensus building. I prefer the term consensus building to compromise, because compromise could cover a whole range of different things. But consensus building, in the sense I mean it, is any mechanism that enables parties with different points of view to reach agreement on an issue of national interest. And one of the biggest dangers in fragile or emerging democracies is that politics becomes so polarized that nobody can give any ground and reach agreements in the national interest, and sometimes that can be very damaging to the state itself and to the population. So I think one of the things that's so marvelous about the Swiss tradition is that you have deeply embedded culture of building compromises and consensus. And that's partly because of the way the whole political process works. You can't move without it. But even in systems where it's not mandated, where it's not a necessary thing because of the way the system works, it's still very beneficial, especially when you're looking at policies, the impact of which will live way beyond the lifetime of one parliament. So things like pensions.
So there is some video I'd like to show, and it's about the new parliament. The recent ones, we call it pushing the buttons. The people who do that, but please, you can show how sometimes the good laws are voted.
Thank you.
Christa, as the president of the National Council in Switzerland, how do you see that?
Well, it's obviously not a good example of good parliamentary governance, because of course every MP is elected to represent its constituents and the people, and of course everybody has a vote, but you should never ever vote for your neighbors who are not present. But we have also or had examples in Switzerland, not that many and not to this extent, but once, because we are sitting rather next to each other and very narrow, and so once an MP voted also for his neighbor who wasn't present, and then we introduced a second button. So you first have to push the first button before you can vote. So you used to your both of your hands, and that's why you can eliminate all those who want to vote for their neighbors who are not present as well.
Oksana,
it's a very practical solution. Yes.
But Oksana, of course it could be done, but still, you know, like you have all these new MPs, and there are some of them, those who like committed to the good discipline, the revolution, but they're still doing like that. And never there are the cases that these laws are considered, you know, taken back, they still are enforced.
Those who were committed, they don't do this. The newcomers do. But those mainly who bought their constituencies for money,
not just.
They practice this quite often. But I think in Ukraine there are a couple of things that actually have framed this. Yes, first of all, we have these requirements that we have to have the 226 votes for any decision, which is the constituents, not constituents, but the majority in the parliament. Not majority of the present, but majority of all, which is very difficult in principle. Yeah. Secondly, we don't have the culture to talk in parliament. So in principle, they voting for another person, this is the lack of culture of consensus building. Because the people were used, that the decisions were made not right. in the parliament, but in other places. And third problem is, of course, the really fast track of decision making. The decision should be cooked in a proper manner, with specific stages. If it's not cooked properly, then it will be raped like this.
Yeah. Olha, you know, we can laugh always. People laugh, journalists laugh when this is it, but these are the serious things. Are they, or how would you explain that? Why it matters? Doesn't?
I think it's very serious problem for Ukrainian parliament, because we remember, all of us remember this case from 16th of January in 2014. And this is a part of that story, is that it's not solution for discipline problem in parliament, because sometimes we will have a problem when parliament will adopt something against constitution, against rule of law, against human rights and something like that, because of this normal situation in parliament. That's why we should stop it as a practice, and all parliamentarians, all MPs must understand that it's their job to be in a plenary session during parliament meeting.
And Mary, how it happens in the other countries? Is it really the bigger thing you can tell? Like, why you talk about this?
This experience is certainly not unique to Ukraine. There are other places where what's often referred to as piano voting takes place. It's usually in a situation where, first of all, the members of the House have not got to the point of defending the reputation of Parliament. They don't see the reputation of Parliament as belonging to them, and therefore they don't see the connection between how they conduct themselves and how the institution is perceived externally. But that is something that does change over time. It also has to do with the way they see their own role. If they have more ownership of the decisions that their factions take, then they take the voting more seriously.
And one topic more I'd like to discuss, it's like this party discipline versus the individual individual responsibility. How is there in Switzerland, you know, because sometimes the I'll give so far, you know, like maybe you would explain how it is us, and I later give an example how we have do it here.
Okay, maybe you got some of the impressions out of the movies when you saw how complicated it is to convince every individual member of parliament for a certain topic, which was, by the way, a complicated one. Mm-hmm. Always when you have to regulate science issues, it's not so obvious as everyone has the scientific background. But still, we have the guarantee by our constitution to vote with a complete freedom without any instruction. But of course, you have also the commitment to your political party. That's why the political parties have an interest that their members of parliament are not completely divided, because you want to put your political weight into the same pot and not just divide yourself. Mm. But there are a lot of issues that you haven't closed votes by the political parties, and you know that there are sensibilities, that are backgrounds, that are professional background or personal convictions, which lead to a different vote than the majority of the party.
Before I go, I just like to give an example that a year ago, your party, Oksana Samopovich, has excluded 5 MPs who had voted in the first reading amendments to the constitution. There are I could definitely name them, but it was not the first time. You probably can also see the Speaker of the Parliament, how he kind of named these people. It was, yeah.
Згідно з протоколом, засідання депутатської фракції «Самопоміч» від 31 серпня 2015 року повідомляю про виключення зі складу депутатської фракції політичної партії «Самопоміч» народних депутатів Гопко Ганни Миколаївни, Єднака Остапа Володимировича, Кишкаря Павла Миколайовича, Кривенка Віктора Миколайовича, Ташник Вікторії Юрівни. Підпис Березюка. Дякую вам.
So there were 5, that's just one of the case, but Oksana, how you really would say that, you know, the party is so strict and the people who were excluded, like Hanna Hopko and Victoria Ptashnik, they are all these new hopes of the Ukrainian new parliament, well-respected, well-known?
The explanation is very easy. The party is new, and it was kind of a risk, and everybody actually committed to this risk when we came to parliament, that we didn't know each other well, but we assumed that we are standing on the same values. And there were only 4 party members at that moment when the party group has been convened in the parliament. And I met some of my faction colleagues only in the parliament. That was also true, because this was because of Maidan, because we were trying to get this chance to be in politics. And it appeared with the time that not all the people actually are ready to commit to those values. And when we got the evidences that those people are actually involved in the political corruption, so it was the major reason.
What do you mean by political corruption?
It was not... they had other obligations, I would say. I would put it this way.
To some other political forces?
To some other political forces, to some other people. And it was the major reason. And for us, the constitutional amendments, it was kind of such a marker, as you, Christopher, mentioning, that it was a very crucial issue for us, for the political party, as for the identity. Because in a lot of other circumstances, of course, every party member is free to vote. But amendments to the constitution, this is something that is very crucial, and especially the amendments that were supposed to provide for the special status of Donbas in the stage of war. So it was kind of the benchmark that we could not afford anymore, and it was a very tough decision to exclude 5 members from the party group.
Well, I have something to respond.
I think it's a very difficult question from you, because it depends on electoral system. If we elected this MP from single mandate district without any political parties, or with political parties, but this MP has responsibility from their citizens, their voters, from this constituency, that's why he can or she can adopt any bill according to the will, political will from their voters, not from only from political parties. The second view, if, for example, we have proportional electoral system and these MPs will vote against ideology of political parties or main position in their program. In their program as a political party, it's a part of responsibility from these MPs to the, his or her political parties. So that's why it's not so easy question, because it depends on the electoral system and a reason why these MPs will vote for this way. Is it corruption or is it views from their voters and program and so on and so forth?
Mary, but you're probably also following how it's going on. There is another, like we can give a number of cases. So for instance, there are maybe some MPs who are probably would be also more known outside of Ukraine as the young reformers, like Mustafa Nayem and Sergei Leshenko. Mm-hmm. And they have stood against more or less their president party, especially by voting against the general prosecutor, accusing there that there is a plot between the oligarch groups, right. And they are more or less would be also accused by the parties that, you know, like you can't leave, you go against your party, yeah, the way that you come to the parliament.
Well, the first thing to say about that, I think, is that political parties in Ukraine, most of them are in a fairly early stage of formation. And during an early stage of party formation, you're not likely to be able to achieve a very high degree of party cohesion. That's something that gets built over time. I think another thing to say is there's no consensus when it comes to international standards as to who owns an MP's mandate. In some jurisdictions, the MP owns their own mandate. In other jurisdictions, it's basically owned by the party. So as Olga says, the electoral system also has something to say about this. I think in practical terms, the thing that helps the most to build a real sense of party identity and party cohesion is to have decision-making processes within the factions that are inclusive. The least disciplined factions are usually those where only one person gets to make a decision, everyone else is expected to follow it. But if you have serious discussion within factions and everyone has an appropriate say, it's easier for people to accept the majority's decision, even if they don't fully agree with it.
And as far as I know, you have in the UK Parliament this kind of position of the person who is called wipe, you know, somebody who makes the members
whip,
of
yes,
the party
yes.
to vote. But I also ask to ask Chris, how you do that? How do you in personally, how do you act? How you do the thing that all members of your party vote?
Well, we also have our political fractions, which means that we meet first before the committees are meeting for a delegation meeting, and we try to get a common sense how to approach an issue or how to deal with concrete proposals or a bill. Then we do have before the plenary session also meetings within our fraction, within our political party, and there we have a very basic democratic discussions, we have votes, and there are also crucial issues that we declare some of the topics as strategic from a political standpoint, from a political point of view, and then we ask friendly our colleagues to vote like two-thirds of the fraction it needs to declare an issue as a strategic.
But you're the head of the National Council today, but have you ever voted in a way that your party agreed, but you didn't really, you know, you personally didn't want to vote for this or that?
Well, during this year, I don't have a vote. So, during my career, it always depends on whether something is very important for me. So there are topics that are less important for me or are not against my personal conviction. So I can also once say, okay, I'm generous. I'm following my party because there are always arguments for both sides. And but there are also a lot of topics some topics that I disagreed with my party and I declared it before.
And you voted differently.
And I voted with my personal conviction, and so it was also accepted.
And Oksana and Olga, if to be short, is there something in our system that maybe doesn't work this way, that maybe this kind of party discipline in this particular thing, in faction, isn't something good or vice versa? How do you think, to be sure?
As I already mentioned, the biggest problem is that in some cases the decisions are made not in parliament, not in the discussion in the faction themselves. For example, in our faction, all the decisions are taken just on the meeting. So the faction sits, the faction discuss, and the decision is made. As far as I know, this is not the case in all factions. And this is the problem. The decisions, the parliamentary decisions, have to be made in parliament. This is crucial.
Just like to clarify, we understand that it's not a violation, but it's kind of this kind of wide gap when which could be used in a way for some of the.
I think that the basic level for democracy and for good parliament is a level of political parties and fractions. Mm-hmm. If there is no any democratic institution or unofficial rules inside the fraction, how to make a deal, how to, how is going on decision-making process and so on and so forth, it's impossible to have good practice inside the parliament generally. And another side of the problem is corruption. It's not only about MPs, it's about fractions too. That's why there is a different situation when, for example, some MPs or a few MPs can be against the fraction because they know how this decision was making without the fraction, without them, and what is the price for this decision. That's why for Ukrainian practice depends on when we are talking about this discipline and decision-making process.
So another topic is about how we play according to the rules and how we can achieve that. So also would like to add that within this history of this last Ukrainian parliament, there were very few, if any, laws which were voted fully according to all the procedures. But there is one special case. I'd also would like to show the video. It was a very, famous law. Everybody's boasting. It's about anti-discrimination amendment. It's on our way for the European integration. And that's how it was done with our current Prime Minister and former head of the Verkhovna Rada.
Тепер є пропозиція без обговорення в цілому, даний проєкт закону в цілому. Прошу голосувати. Приймати. Друзі, ще раз вношу пропозицію. Увага! Ще раз ставлю пропозицію. В цілому, від авторського проєкту, без обговорення, від авторського колективу, прошу підтримати дану пропозицію. 3442 в другому читанні та в цілому. Шановні колеги, народні депутати. Ще раз, шановні колеги, народні депутати. Звертаюсь до всіх колег, народних депутатів. Перше, заспокоїтесь. Сконцентруватись і розглянути пропозицію 3442 в другому читанні та в цілому, відповідно до пропозиції авторського колективу. Голосуємо 3442, прошу підтримати. Зараз буде пропозиція про те, щоб, відповідно до процедури ad hoc, те, що ми говорили з вами, проголосувати в другому читанні та в цілому даний проєкт закону за пропозицією авторського колективу без обговорення. Зрозуміло? Голосуємо, колеги. Колеги, 15 хвилин перерва для консультацій. Дякую.
So within 2 minutes, there were for 6 times when the law had to be put on vote, which is not really the case as it should be. I know that there were things where it was even more times, but that was pretty unique within this very short period in time. And how we do with that? Can we really? And this law is still there.
This is again the lack of consensus. This is the lack of proper procedure and the lack of discussion, because very important issues, they have to be talked through. Though the MP, if this is about anti-discrimination, the MP had to have time to think about this, to go to their people, to check, to at least those who have good intents, to explain their position. If it is not done properly, especially if government didn't talk to anybody, neither to MPs nor to the public, it was not explained at all. It was done overnight. Such decision that if there is an attempt to make such a decision overnight, that will always destroy any consensus that would be even preliminary existing in the parliament.
But Olga, we have this law. They are still there, and we live according to these laws voted in that way.
I think it's a good case about last night's students' draft law, because usually Volodymyr Groysman said that it is a problem of our government because they didn't send us any draft laws, and we've got it during last night. All MPs can read it, and this is the reason. But we need to adopt this law because of IMF credit line or because of EU association agreement and something like that. But you know, this is illness side of our parliament, because if we had during this last year more than 5,000 draft laws in our parliament, and it's impossible to read all of them, even read all of them. That's why our parliament should have a priorities agenda, open agenda for MPs. They should prepare a political dialogue process before it, understood what is going on, what is this law about, and so on. So maybe good objectives, but bad way to this objective.
But really, could that kind of things happen? And what you really do? Maybe you just don't have so many draft laws.
Well, I would say this case couldn't happen in our parliament because we have very clear rules and procedures, but I can also say we are a long-term democracy, and so there are rules in place for a long time.
I would just add that in particular your position is existing since 1848, yes, 1848, so it's more than a century and a half.
Exactly. But still, it is important, I think, the whole procedure, having clear timelines, because it's important for a parliament to being well prepared before you have the debates in the committees, before you have the debates in the plenary session. And of course, in today's world, it happens also in our parliament that the government just files something and say, it's very important. So you have to be fast. So then it's always a critical one. Also, when we had this situation, we had the situation not during my presidency, but 3 years before, when we had to push through, or should push through, a law allowing the United States of America having a special program for the Swiss banks, which were accused by the U.S. For helping tax avoiders. And so the law was not accepted under this pressure by the parliament, because the parliament resists of the pressure. Yeah. Of the government, which is shows also a kind of separating of powers, and which is also maybe at the end of the day risky, because it can come out in a bad way. Fortunately, the result was acceptable, and the result is good, but it was a risky way how to deal between the two institutions, government and parliament.
Mary, can you really enforce that, like strict rules and procedures by papers or some other ways? If you speak about any other countries without that long history as Switzerland or the United Kingdom?
I mean, the first thing I'd like to say is that, yes, enforcement is possible. It requires political will. It requires a critical mass.
Political will of whose political will? Not all members of parliament, but...
No, it requires a critical mass of members to place a higher priority on the reputation and organisational culture of parliament as an institution. And under those circumstances, enforcement becomes possible, but it does take a bit of time. It takes several iterations. You have to gradually build up that sense that actually it's in everybody's interests for Parliament to have its own political identity. That does take some time. And in the Ukrainian context, Ukraine has been in an emergency situation, dealing with external aggression, economic crisis, and so on. And in those circumstances, it's understandable that not every goal can be met right away. That's understandable. What I think is going to help Ukraine a lot, and this has already happened in an agreement with the European Parliament, is that the goals have been agreed as to how Parliament should function in the future. And now there needs to be a process of gradually, step by step, working towards those goals. But it will take some time. Everyone has to be a little bit patient.
And we'd like also to discuss, you know, where is the difference between, let's say, the dialogue, agreement, and the deal, and sometimes the deal which is done behind the closed doors. Because we have a particular number of cases, because there is one deal when you say, like, you take position in this, I have this position on that law, but sometimes we know there are the cases when, for instance, the parties agreed to vote for somebody if their person would be, I don't know, promoted as the head of some another government body, body or something like that. So, Oksana, to be very honest, in this late night discussion, what kind of deals, you know, like, you know, like, you know, and you know, what is the difference, you know, the deals behind the closed doors?
I think it is not a secret that the deals in Ukrainian parliament that are not real, and I feel kind of awkward in this, you know, in this place, because I'm the only one from Ukrainian parliament, and I have to take the, all the guilt, and it's true.
That's your position, you know?
Yeah, that's true. But what I would say, but this is all from the origin of the problem. Yeah, the immaturity comes from the lack of the culture of decision-making process. If the decisions, as I mentioned, they are not taken in the parliament, they will be, the parliament will be from time to time, as I would say, raped to take the decision in this or that, on this or that matter. And the deal is part of this culture. Because if you do not respect the parliament as an institution, doesn't matter whether you sit in the parliament or you sit outside of the parliament, whether it's government or the president, it doesn't matter. But if you do not respect the parliament as an institution, it means that you will force the parliament to the deal, not to the consensus. And the deal, it means that there is a personal interest behind that. And the consensus means that there is a common interest behind this, the agreement. Yeah. And this is the difference. So if the decision, this is from what I learned already, being on my position and being in the number of the discussion, when there is a real intent to find the consensus, it is always doable. But when there is a real need to do the deal, those who are not interested in the deal, they are just thrown away.
You know, Oksana, is it, Olha, is it really the case? And you're traveling to Minsk, you're also talking on this, you're participating in this process which is taking place with the OSCE mediation, especially regarding this, at this time, very politicized and controversial story on the elections on the territories which are probably under Ukrainian government control. And how do you see that? That there is, like, unpopular topic nobody really wants because it's, like, heavily politicized, parties don't want. And always complain, it's a deal, you know.
No, I think it's a story about political dialogue too, and I want to push, I don't know, Ukrainian side in Minsk and our president and our parliament to talk to each other about Minsk agreement and our way, how we will get our objectives in this process. It is a problem, and during this summer, we organized a few meetings in parliament with all political fractions, and do you know that not all of them visited these meetings. Just talk about what is going on inside Minsk, what is our point of discussion, what is our position, and so on and so forth. That's why it's a problem, because they have mostly political will to discuss in TV channel about this, but they don't want to talk about this truly, eyes to eyes, you know, without any broadcasting, and it is a problem. And I want to add one thing about decision-making process. When you have a real decision-making process according to procedures, you will have a healthy child. Because it's like a pregnancy, you know? You can born a healthy child if you didn't have the 38 or 40 weeks of pregnancy. This is the same story. A political dialogue is like a pregnancy. That's why in many parliaments in the world, it's like, I don't know, new child. They are working with this new bill or this program or this reform during a long period because they need to find equality decisions inside these new ideas which will be adopted like a bill. And it's not about our parliament now because there is no political will and sometimes it's easily to have a deal in the closed offices, but not in parliament, unfortunately.
But also, before we go for that, there was the, let's say, recommendation done by former head of the European Parliament, Pat Cox, who is often traveling to Ukraine. So there were like more than 52 recommendations, and number 11 was to, you know, to have this discussion before the voting that they are closed, that they are not for cameras, because you have a lot of like people speak on. About their positions rather than they really want to do that. So how it's really working in your case and how you decide, is everything transparent or you don't show some of the things?
Well, the committee meetings that was also shown in the film, they are behind closed doors. And there is one simple reason. After having discussed a bill or a topic or an agreement, we have a transparent discussion and also reporters of the committee of the majority decision and of the minority to present it in the plenary session in parliament. But in order that everybody can also move, can find a compromise, can find a solution, does not lose its face in this whole decision-finding process, that's why it's not a spectacle for the media, for the public scene. That's why these meetings are behind closed doors, and I would say we have a good experience with that.
But you said there are some people tweeting and doing their social media.
Well, I would say tweeting out of the committee meetings is not a real issue, but we had cases that there were tweets out of the plenary session, which is anyway streamlined, which is very accessible for everyone who has a computer. But I mean, just to blame colleagues on social media, this is not a good way to use Twitter or to use social media. You can use it to promote your political ideas or successes, that's correct, and that's good, or also to explain something, to give some background information, but not just to have an unpolitical debate, like a personal blaming.
There is, Mary, that I would be the first question to you. There was the pretty good interview this week done by the Ukrainian political analyst Mikhail Minakov, and he more or less complains that, of course, we inherited this legacy of the distrust between the old political groups in order to build consensus, because there were always, you know, people. There was always a place for treason in that case. But the young MPs are also very radical to show their principle thing, to show that they're, you know, like. They wouldn't be the not patriots or things like that. So how do you see? Are they really so radical?
Well, one of the things that's very interesting is that quite a number of the people elected in 2014 who were new to politics, who came from civil society or the media, that they actually have shown the way on cross-party cooperation. They formed a cross-party caucus very early on. They have very active discussions within that caucus. There are other cross-party formations in the parliament as well that work very well, like the Equal Opportunities Caucus, which is a mix of new MPs and those who've been elected before. So I think there really is the potential for cross-party cooperation in all of its many different forms, both formal and informal, to take root in the Ukrainian parliament. I'm an optimist about this.
Oksana, do you want to have more of the discussions behind the closed door without TV cameras?
I just want to have more discussions in principle, because this is what is very much lacking in Ukrainian parliament, the culture of just talking with the intent to find the consensus. Not talking, just talking, but to find the consensus on different issues. And I think that we are just learning. This is the first parliament in Ukraine that is really practicing those practical talking on the issues that need political consensus.
Ola, do you have this high opinion as your organization is a watchdog?
No, I'm not agree with this recommendation, but if you are talking about this Monday meeting with political fraction, it can be under the closed doors. It's not a problem, but if you are talking about committee meeting and discussion, it should be, it must be open because of our political context, and it's not only how I will looks like without camera as a deputy, as MP. It's about decision-making process. It's about arguments. It's about falsification of results of committee meetings and adopted draft laws and so on and so forth. It's very important to show most of the process of preparing draft laws.
Chris, so we always think in Ukraine, and there are the reasons to that, there are a lot of the like bureaucrats who are political. We have the issues when the general prosecutor, you know, taking the political stance on some of the issues. But you said you also have a bit of the cases with the political involvement of the general prosecutor, and particularly regarding yourself.
Well, it happens, I think, in every jurisdiction or even in every country, that sometimes competences are sometimes used to a huge extent, I would say, once. And of course, our justice is independent, and our general prosecutor should it as be as well. But it seems also to be a political position because he is elected by the parliament, and that's also why it's in a way a position which has a political impact, and so this position can also be used for political reasons.
And to finalize, we already see also the change in globally that we have populists, the things which hadn't been accepted before are accepted. If you go to, you know, like countries where the Ukrainian, either they are the Ukrainian neighbors like Hungary or Slovakia, you have sometimes some far-right figures, it would be unacceptable. There would be sometimes the hate speech in the parliament. It would be also in some countries which we see that, you know, exemplary, like the Denmark or the Sweden. So, Mary, I would like to have this round to be very short. How do you see that, and how we get out of that? Because people are elected. This is, you know, we have Donald Trump who says something, and he has public support.
Even more dramatic case in the Philippines, I think, where the current president has more than 90% support and is clearly a populist. It is a global trend, and one that is born out of a big gap between people's expectations and their actual lives. And that can be exploited by politicians in ways that are harmful. One has to hope that this is short-lived and that the lessons of history don't have to be learned again.
So, Chris, you do have the question, like, immigration is currently in Europe all over the place. The thing that there are talks which couldn't be, accepted maybe 3 or 4 years ago, but now they're getting popular, and the political center is going, you know, to that direction. And so how you do that, what are the challenges, and what are your answers? Or don't you have this, or you don't have these troubles?
Well, as we just have heard, I mean, populism is a global phenomenon, but my big concern is that it affects also old and experienced democracies, such as the United States of America, such as Switzerland. We also see populist movements in our country, but we have a strong institutional system which is able, in a way, to deal with. But still, we have seen that some populist proposals raised by popular initiatives, which is a right of the citizens, passed regarding, for instance, immigration, just to limit immigration to Switzerland. And now we get a problem because we don't know how really to solve the problem, because there are conflicting interests by fulfilling our European obligations with the European Union, but also to respect the outcome of this popular vote. So populism is a phenomenon that we have also to address as elected members of parliament, that we have to demonstrate our respect to our voters, to their expectation, but we have also to be honest. We have to explain our politics, we have also to say what is possible and what isn't, and I think then you can have an honest, open dialogue with the voters and maybe diminish a little bit the populism.
So we are wrapping up, and if to be very short, Oksana, what would be your recipe? Like one short thing when you think we can really, you know, let's say confront this kind of the rising the level of tension and is. In the parliament, people fight.
With regard to the populism, this is very simple. This is the general challenge of the world. The world facing global challenges, and people are looking for the simple decisions.
What do we do in Ukraine?
Not to be lazy and to be honest. Talk to people, tell the truth, even though it's very, very hard talk. But in principle, if you are honest, if you go down to the village, to the town, to the community, and if you talk, people are able to hear, and this is what I know for good.
I think that answer is very easy. It's strong state and check and balance system. Because in those countries where the state system is very strong, even a big number of populace in parliament doesn't matter, really.
Okay, so for that, I'd like really to thank for this incredible and unique, pretty discussion. But we have our own postscriptum because Ukrainian audience voting. Krista, you are guest, so we really would like to know, you know, what are the expenses of the president of the National Council? How much benefits do you have? So that would be something everybody is very curious. So we would say is our postscriptum of the program. How many ADs? Cars and all the things you have.
Well, we are a parliament without big privileges, which means we have no drivers, we have a general ticket for the train, we have no individual staffers, we get just a credit for engaging a student and having our own laptop, and we don't have pensions when we retired or are not re-elected, but we get some contribution to our private pension plan. So we are actually cheap.
But you are working.
And we are working, exactly. We are not full-time members of parliament, that we have always to underline. We have also our proper job. But we are actually a cheap parliament, but I would also say rather efficient parliament.
So, okay, thanks again for everybody. And I really hope you've enjoyed this discussion.